Let's go deeper into 18XX Purgatory. This is 1826. This is, I think, the original production of it by Chris Lawson. And I don't know the full relation. I know the game's offered through Deep Thought now, or was at one point. The game itself is by Hecht. He's done a number of 18XX games. I think this may be his first. I'm not positive. He's done some big ones. It's a very interesting one. So, first off, this is not a good intro to XX. Go look at my 18AL or 1830 or something, or someone else's videos, if you want to learn about 18XX. This is a game and a video review, well, intro, intended for people who already are familiar with 18XX. Given that, though, even there, this is my first play, and the rules are not really familiar, and there are some significant changes from the core XX type rules, as well as a rule book that's maybe not as polished as it could be. I don't know if the Deep Thought one is in, it has been cleaned up at all. This isn't terrible, but it wouldn't be one I'd want to approach as my first XX game by any means. This game feels like 1856 from the rules reading. It's got a lot of the 1856 elements, but it adds layers onto them. So, for example, it's going to have loans in it over here. They're bigger loans. They're 500 francs in this case, but money is, you know, fairly similar. You can see the two trains are 100. The four trains, whoa, no threes, huh? Trains are strange. The H's on the trains, this is where it gets weird. Those are the number of hexes the trains can travel through. Taking the idea that your steam trains, and diesels for that matter, their fuel and capability is really based on distance rather than how many cities they visit. That changes when we get to the modern trains, the electronic or electric trains, and the TGV. France didn't have a lot of diesel trains. They kind of nationalized and went to electronic trains at a fairly early date. And then the TGV is your high speed, which requires its own special track, etc. And you'll see that doesn't actually get fleshed out. Well, got hair on. I'm using plexiglass because the game basically was just a game kit. It came with four sheets of paper. I paid a fortune for something that's kind of iffy on components there. All the cards are nice and laminated. I don't know, you know, how much the owner did this or how much this was the initial kit. I didn't look at the presentation. I picked it up used. But this is a rarity, and it looked like an interesting one that I'm not going to be able to get my hands on. I've had Deep Thought games on order for, you know, I don't know, 5 years now, more than that maybe, and I got 100 ahead of me, which I've had for several years in terms of one of them. One of them seems to be moving up more. I don't know how his process works. You see these little cubes. Those are just destination markers. They're on the map quite often in game, in XX games. If there's a destination, it's hard to see, to remember where it is once there's a tile on top of it. Well, this is the answer to that. You have this little marker to put on top. Regular wooden tokens for stations. They're double-sided to handle being able, we're going to have two nationalized railroads. Like I said, it's 56, but kind of bloated with some additional material on top of it, like the way the trains work. I'm always intrigued to see how much effect 1856 has had on the game, on the system as a whole. I know some guys who posted pictures. They have this big wooden elephant that they pass around as their priority deal. It's just, I mean, a big one, not like the 56 one, but it's just so weird how much effect that had. The priority deal existed in games well before it and was always handled with a card. Now the elephant's become the symbol of priority deal somehow. And what do we got? So this is a stock market, which is pretty standard looking. The yellow zone is going to be doesn't count against your certificate limit. You're going to have certificates that don't count against your limit too. Notably, one of the corporations, one of the nationalized corporations, has the possibility to release bonds, and those don't count against your certificate limit. This is kind of a cute little thing. It gives you, for each number of players, the starting capital and the base certificate limit for those players. And then there's a card to show you the whole thing, which is also available on the board. The four colors of track going up to gray, kind of becoming pretty standard at this point. Cash money is thin, but it's not slickery. So it may be reasonable if I can get some bend into it. I don't feel like using coins for this, and I don't have mini poker chips or anything like that. Well, I might be tempted. You have a lot of different corporations in this game, but they probably aren't going to all make it through the game. All right, let's start tackling the rules. Your phases of the game correspond with the trains as usual. The maximum number of trains. Okay, so here's one of the interesting concepts in the game. You're going to have two different types of corporations in the game. When you start corporations early in the game, they start off with only 5 shares worth 20% each, but then they upgrade. And if a corporation is one of those 5 share corporations, it's only allowed less. It's allowed less trains at the beginning of the game. That becomes a moot point once you get up to the 10H train. If you're different rails, different tiles, which are available at different points as usual. Number of operating rounds between stock rounds, what gets rusted. And then here, so this is kind of interesting. It looks to me like private companies can be bought right away because they have their special abilities. The 6H and 10H train can cause two nationalized companies to form. First the 6H can cause one, then the 10H and actually the E have a chance of forming that. The early nationalized company may not form at all. Actually, neither one may form, but it's pretty likely that the second one, the SNCF, does. Let's take a look at stock prices, how they move, make sure I understand it. I've read through it, but moves down one for each sale, for each share sold. If you're completely sold out of bank pool, corporation, treasury, or initial offering, i.e. 10 shares have to be sold, but I'm not sure about that because the initial offering. So the 5 extra shares may not exist at the during this point, and that's what's kind of hard to tell. So if you're completely sold out, you get a row up movement like in 30. If you don't pay out, either because you can't or because you withheld dividends, your share price is going to move left. If you take out a loan, your share price moves left a space. If you pay back a loan, it moves back right. And there's little movement arrows that indicate, hey, if you're banging against the wall, you go up. There's no special movement like there is in 70 that allows you to get off the top row, though. And there's also no closed. Sequence of play, pretty much your basic here. Stock round, except in the stock round, several games have this, but you must sell stock before you buy your one share that you're allowed to, or your one certificate you're allowed to buy. When you start a corporation, you put, you get to set the par value at any one of these. Par value, I don't think matters in this game. There aren't enough tokens to handle, and there's no space to handle tracking the par value. So I think all transactions are going to be handled at the current market value, which kind of makes sense. An IPO doesn't just sit around there at the value that it was started at forever. On the initial stock round, you have the miners get auctioned off in the standard fashion. It has to be multiples of $5 for this, so no weird little amounts here. And also, the special rules involving the first one is if everybody passes, the person with priority has to buy this at full value. Which is kind of, I consider that kind of a bone compared to the 1830 rules. Because you might not want to buy it. What's not clear there is what happens if you've allocated so much money that you can't buy it, which could easily happen. And it might just be with, if people make excessive bids, etc., that no one can buy it, which is why I like the 1830 rules better. I don't know what happens because that money's been allocated but not paid. The rules to this seem to indicate that you can pay it, and I don't know where it comes from. We probably won't have that problem with the way that I automate the bidding because I don't know what I'm doing in the game, so I can't make really informed bids about these companies. We have a list of them. Let's take a look at what we have. The Ponce Echelsius. This guy. If a corporation owns him, his special ability is to place a river hex free of charge. Actually, you know, I don't remember corporations being able to buy private companies. So let me look at these again. Private companies, they can be bought from the bank during the initial one's purchase. They remain in the purchase. Oh no, they stay. They cannot be bought by corporation. So you can just close out the Ponce Echelsius in order to take effect its special ability, which is the corporation can place a tile on a river hex free of charge. The Rige de Postis gets two of these, it seems like. It can increase the value of a city by 10 for all of its runs. Place one of the tokens on the corporation and the other one on the city. Okay, so it's kind of like the port marker and stuff like that. During token placement, this is in addition to any station tokens that you can purchase. And once played, you can't move them, and this closes the company. And since you're getting, you know, funds from this into your own private money, it might be a hard decision to close a private company this way. Chemise de Fer d'Alger gives you this bonus that allows you to keep, you get to drop this on a corporation, closing the private company, and it allows your corporation to have one extra train on it. That's pretty neat, actually. But it's an expensive piece of property. The Grand Central Belge gets 10% of the Etat Belge, which is over there. You'll have to forgive me, my camera, it's cranky. All my stuff is dying at once. As soon as he buys the private company will close once the Etat Belge buys its first train. Now, he doesn't get to set the price for it, and he's paying 110, which is a lot of money. That's at the high end of the par values there. You didn't get to see that, but would have just kept zooming in and you would have never gotten the focus. The Paris-Rouen gets the presidency of the Chemin de Fer de Paris, another corporation. And he must set the starting value at the time the private company closes when the railroad buys its first train. And very similarly, the Ligne Strasbourg-Bâle is going to give you the presidency of the Alsace. And he must set the starting value. And when the company buys its first train, this also goes away. Well, this one looks like a hell of a deal. Two shares that you can set at 110 for 160 bucks. This one, a little less. This one looks risky as hell. Just as an initial look at this. Private companies are going to close when the 10H comes out. If they haven't done their special ability, you're screwed. The special power tokens disappear when the E phase starts, which is interesting because, you know, if you're collecting 15 or 10 bucks from this, you might want to keep collecting that money until the 10H comes out or close to it, but then you don't have very long where you have the special power. Hard call there. Okay, this is where things get weird now. Corporations other than the Etat Belge formed prior to phase 6H, which have not yet reached their destination. All companies have a destination. And there aren't very many of those markers on the board, which is what confuses me. I've got to find... And these probably can't get overlaid before we get the 6Hs, so they don't need cubes. These guys could have yellow track over them, and that's why they have a cube. They're going to be 5-share corporations and have 5 shares available. The presidency will be worth 40% of the company, everything else worth 20. But later, they're going to get cut in half so that they're worth 10% per share. And that's going to be marked, but we'll see here, does some of these say preferred stock on them? Well, lower issues in there, which I have upside down, do not say that. And once you release the standard stock or whatever, you're not going to have that problem. Or you're not going to have the 5 shares being the maximum. This makes sense in some ways in terms of how money should be released. I've always had a problem with how 1830 kind of releases the cash to a corporation. But most attempts to fix that, like, well, the corporation owns the shares or whatever, but they're all available to be purchased, is weird. Here you're going to actually have the right to release the shares. Once 50% or more of the available shares of the corporation, and remember, at the beginning, that's only 3 shares, are available, in the hands of players, the corporation floats. As soon as it floats, the player who owns the president's certificate gets the corporate charter, and they get initial capital, which is going to be based on the float value here. So what you'll see here is if you started at 100 a share, the float value is only $300. But the other shares go into the corporate treasury and then are bought from the corporate treasury for cash from the treasury, for cash that goes into the treasury. A la lots of games, actually. But 56 has this factor. You're going to have a certain number of initial tokens. So if you start as an early company, you only get 3 tokens for the whole game. If you start later as a 10-share company in the once your destination's been reached, you'll get an extra token. And if you start in the 10H TGV era, you get 5 tokens total. So that's... the companies that start later are inherently going to be bigger, which is a kind of neat factor. And the counter mix handles this. Every corporation has 5 tokens. So everything except the bottom row of corporations, the 2 national, well, 3 national ones, one of them is the Belgian national, are going to have a destination. If the corporation forms before the 6H train is purchased, they follow the destination rules. And you can only sell preferred stock, or that's all that's in play, until the destination's reached. The initial offering remains the corporation's remaining 5 shares, and any dividends paid are divided among the 5 shares of preferred stock. However, 5-share corporations have their train limit reduced from 4 to 2. We had that somewhere over here during this period. So you're not going to see someone throw down a company and buy up all the trains with it right away. Again, lots of interesting little... that, I think, again, is more historically accurate. Usually, the early rail companies were tentatively sticking their toe in the water rather than, you know, coming in and just driving the advances the way that they often do in games, for whatever reason you want to look at them. But it does provide an interesting space to explore no matter what. Once a corporation connects to its destination and decides that it wants to be a 10-share corporation, the remaining 5 shares become available and they go in the corporate treasury where they're going to produce more money for the corporation. A corporation can be connected to its destination either on its own operations or by someone else hooking it up. And the connection is just going to be tracing a legal route from its home station to its destination station, using a train of arbitrary length, ignoring station tokens belonging to other corporations. Basically, you got track that hooks you up. It doesn't matter what else. That is, I think, 56 uses that system. 70, you have to be able to run the train between them, I believe, which makes it a harder job. We have a list of the different corporations, where they start, whether their train limit is normal, and whether they are merge eligible. In particular, the interesting ones are the Belgian, which is not able to be merged into the French railways. The Chemist de Fayolle, the state railroad, the first state railroad, can be merged into the second state railroad. It has an extra train available, and the second state railroad, or the national railroad, has an extra train available as well. And remember, we have this for that as well. Okay, What about the first of these? So these kind of work the same way, which is when a phase change happens, you assess whether or not, how many corporations there are that have run already in the phase change. No, prior to that phase. They've run already in the game and they have no train available. And they're going to get compounded into the nationalized railways. So the first one is at the 6H. If that kills your only trains, and it will kill the 2Hs. So if all you have are 2Hs aboard your corporation, and you've been, you know, you've operated, I'm not sure. Yeah, you might end up merging into it. Now, you don't merge in if only one corporation is in that state. But if two corporations or more are, they're going to all be forced to merge and create this new corporation. And they do a merger that is trading in two shares for one. And there's some mechanisms to handle how that is taken care of. The same general principle applies when you get to the national railway. The starting value is going to be the average in both cases of the two top merged companies. Okay. So the station tokens for the companies have a flip side, or for the corporations have a flip side, which corresponds to these corporations so that they can shift into them. And the ATOT is able to take, I believe, two token markers from each corporation that merges into it. It's also going to get an additional, three additional station token markers. And he gets any cash and special tokens from the merged corporations. If the ATOT does not form on the phase 6H exchange, it'll never enter play. If any of the corporations that make it up have run in that operating round, it doesn't get to run until the next operating round. Okay, something I forgot to mention I didn't forget. The rules, the ordering. Normally a corporation on its first turn when it starts gets to lay two yellow tracks on the first turn. These advanced, merger companies do not get that. Okay, so the national works the same way, except it hits when the 10 train or the E train is first sold. So if that knocks out two players, it can form. And it is possible that it would not form there. It does have some differences, however, which is that there's the capability of more corporations falling into this thing. After the first 10 shares, there's a pile of bonds available, which are what get traded in after shares are no longer available for trading in. Those bonds can be in players' hands, they can be in the bank pool, they don't count as certificates, they can be in the bank pool, or they could even be in the corporation treasury for what it's worth. And they have a face value of 100 francs, and you can, the corporation can buy them back for that though, at its desires. Let's see if there's anything really exciting here. Okay. Loans that are inherited will drop the value of the SNCF, and then it's going to get bonds into the bank pool for each loan. Loans affect the stock value of this? No, because they're already sitting on the shares, I think. Okay. However, so its starting value can't be less than 110, but does that affect... I think the loans get assessed after that. It also gets station token replacement, starting with the home station tokens. It's going to operate normally. Well, the same as the other one if it hasn't had anyone go. The SNCF is going to pay interest on the bonds on each operating round, and it pays 10 francs in interest. The number of corporations still in play after the SNCF has an opportunity to form is going to determine how many of these 10H trains are available. And if we really kill the corporations, there won't be many available. Okay. What can the president do? So the president gets to lay track, and we've got costs for crossing mountains and rivers. If he reaches his destination, he has the option to drop the 5 shares held in the initial offering into his corporation treasury. That waters down all his shares, but may get more operating money for him. Again, I think a nice compromise where the president has the opportunity to decide whether or not to expand. And by the way, this mark, this is just, I am having trouble aligning the things. I don't think it'll be a big deal. Okay, train routes. Not quite how they work in most XX games. Generally the same, but most of these values are given in hexes that you can transit. And if you go through the same hex twice, it counts as 2 separate hexes, I think. I'm not sure. Nah, I don't think so. I think it's just actual hexes traveled. You can't run twice to the same hex for score, though. So, for example, you couldn't run Paris to Paris, which kind of makes sense, I guess. I always liked those kind of runs. Off-map has many different values available. And if we can find Alsace here. Yeah, it doesn't turn weird. I thought maybe this area would get, you know, up and down money because of it converting to Germany during the war. So you count the number of hexes that you transit, but you get money for the cities and towns that you travel through. This is different for the electric and TGV trains. The electric train is really screwy. It's got this little chart on it. However many E trains are in play, that's how many cities that it can hit. It ignores towns, the small boinkers. But then, and that increases each time. More than that, that D on there, that indicates it gets double value from each city it hits, which can be quite potent, I would assume. But once all of the E trains are out and the first TGV is bought, it can hit 5 cities, but it's no longer doubled. So it's not going to make as much money even if it has a bigger route. These guys run as a 3D train. Just like an E train with 3D, it can hit 3 cities doubled. They can run on track that other trains of yours have run on. They can't double up on their own track, though. Like, you can't run the same TGV over the same track. And I think you're only allowed 1 per corporation of those. so you don't have to worry about them running on their on each other's track. You have to pay interest on your loans. Loans are 500 francs, which is a big pile of money. The interest is 10% of that, 50 francs per turn. From what I can see of the rules, you don't pay on the first turn you get the loan. You can only get loans if you must. You can't do like in 56 and try to decide, oh yeah, I'm looking at a big expansion. Let's take out lots of loans. No, but there's no real benefit to having them here. When you pick it up, remember it affects your stock value. When you sell it, when you pay it off, it also does. And you can only buy it if your interest on loans forces you to need cash, or buying a new train forces you to. It's sort of another step before the president has to start selling off shares. There's full, half, and withheld dividends. A full dividend is going to be the company's earnings divided by the number of shares there are. That's either going to be 5 or 10. A half dividend is going to be half the full dividend. And I think your share, your stock price doesn't change in that case. And if you withhold, your stock price goes down and the corporation takes all the cash. Oh. You can buy trains. Then you can repay loans. The SNCF can buy back bonds. And the players don't have an option on this. Corporations can sell their treasury stock to the bank pool. Now, there's some weird rules on this. You can't do this during emergency money raising, but it doesn't look like there's any prohibition doing it just before emergency money raising in your run. That disturbs me a little bit. It kind of makes the rule against doing it in emergency money raising somewhat moot. You might decide the intention of that is that you can't make a stock release when you're going to hell, in which case you probably shouldn't be allowed to do it if you have an emergency money raising going forward that turn. I may play with that. So basically, you're just, it's the corporation dumping its certificates into the bank pool within limits. You're only allowed 50% of the bank pool normally. There are some exceptions in this game. It can also instead buy shares out of the bank pool. If you sell shares to the bank pool, it does affect the stock price after you sell it, just as selling shares during the stock round would. If you don't have a train and you operated, you must buy one. It's not an 1830 where you can like starve a company. You can take out loans if you need them to raise money. If you've taken out your maximum loans, which is $2,000, that should pay most things. the biggest train is $1,000, but maybe you're sitting on a couple loans there. Then you have to start selling off shares. It's possible to go bankrupt in this game. It doesn't end the game. If you go bankrupt, your shares go in the bank pool, essentially. Any shares you weren't able to sell. That might end up having a president with only one share in charge of a company, and it handles that. This means that A, you can't engineer a win by going bankrupt, which is something I'd love to see, but you also don't spoil everyone else's game by playing badly. This was something that always bugged the shit out of me when I heard about the World Board Gaming Competition, where people would show up, they'd be playing binary win-loss because that's all that matters for getting wood, and, you know, hey, I'll take a high-risk opportunity, which if it pays off, I probably win when the game crashes, because somebody else is going to do the same thing. And if it crashes on me, well, I didn't spend too long playing. So the games end up being very quick, but because nobody's trying to assure their position in the game, trying to make sure that they do well, they're only interested in what are my odds of getting a first place or second place finish or whatever. That's the only thing that matters to them. What they want is a short game to make the most money early. And you'll never see someone developing their trains long term. You don't see the same strategy coming into play. You see something that seems really a neutered version of 1830 to me. Anyway, this game has it baked in that you can't do that. You go bankrupt? Fine, bye. We'll play. Okay. You are allowed to buy trains from other companies starting in 6H, which is kind of late. Normally, it's the second, the three trains or whatever. And I believe that can be done at any negotiated value as long as you have the cash. You can't use a loan for that, can you? Better not be able to. A company with one or more loans outstanding may only buy trains at face value or less, and may only sell trains at face value or more. Yeah. So you can't try to engineer more money into your company and then rape it. Which makes the game a little less volatile and a little less dicky, but we'll see. We'll see how this works anyway. I like the 1830, 1856 model for that. Excuse me. Then you're allowed to lay track. You can either upgrade or place. All kinds of rules here. Most specifically, this is interesting, is each of these spaces is reserved for the corporation that's adjacent to it. And that corporation will not allow you to place in those spaces unless it's got a president and is an operating corporation. If it's got a president, he has the right to allow you after examining what your track lay would be. So you can set something up that's in his best interests and yours, and he can okay it. An interesting compromise there to the frozen out spaces. The idea is you can't keep somebody from starting their company in Paris, basically. Anything else here? Limits to the trains. They're all largely what you'd expect. Got some indications here of what goes in specific spaces, some special tracks. distance-based token placement. When you lay a station, it's going to cost you 20 times the number of hexes away it is. But you have to trace those hexes through running track. And this is what's weird here. It's the same issue that I have with using hexes for movement. If I have track that I go through twice, that I go through the hex twice, how should I assess that? For example, this piece. I could come up this way, around, and over, and I've gone through that hex twice. In terms of distance, I think I've traveled two hexes. And that's how I'm going to play it, but that's not how the rules read in either case. It's probably a pretty rare situation. So I'm not going to worry too much either way about it. And I got the rest of the track in the box right now. We talked about the electric trains already. We talked about the TGV. The game ends when the bank runs out of money. You play one more set of operating rounds. If you're in the middle of an operating round, you finish the setup. If you're in a stock round when it happens, you play a complete set of operating rounds. And then whoever's got the most money wins. The SNCF loses 10 francs per share per bond at that point. If anybody has loans at that point, they lose 50 francs per share per loan. This could end up giving you negative share value on your corporations. Too bad. Another interesting idea in it. Game includes some historical notes, which I always like to read because I'll tell you, I usually don't understand where all the ideas behind the corporations and you know, why the game is designed in a particular way would be the case until I've read them. And reading them helps tremendously in kind of seeing why the particular modifications that were chosen were and what's going on with that. It also gives you some historical background, which is always nice too. Anything else to say? So, there's sort of the 18XX has a weird kind of system about it, right? In terms of looking at all the different games in the family and how they relate. It's almost like CDGs are. It's not like, say, Age of Steam's expansion maps, which may have a few little rules changes. This has core rule changes, and almost every XX game, almost, seems to have its own little take. And its own little take sometimes involves historical factors, like the electric train being added in and being a big factor in France. But others, like capitalization and everything, don't really seem to be terribly linked to the particular situation. They seem to be the designer's view of an interesting game and maybe a better historical representation of what they see is happening in all of the circumstances. I feel like loans in 56 were that. Some of the connection runs in some of the games. This one, like in 70, there's a bounty being paid for connections. 56 as well, to some extent. That was generally locally paid. But here the national government is paying a bounty for you to hook up those destinations, in the sense that your actual charter is partially funded by the government for you to do that. And it frees you up, you know, to issue more stocks or whatever. But it's different ways of looking at things. Oh, what's this chart for? This is to track your dividend payouts. I really like that because it allows me to see at a glance how well any given company is. It's not essential to the game, I think. Well, wait a minute. I forgot something. The stock movement is actually based slightly on the dividend payouts. Not like it is in... Jeez, what did I play recently that was heavily that way? I can't find it. My mind is saying 46, but that may not be it. There's a recent buy by me, and I don't know where it is. So I'm going to have to just pass on hunting it down. May have been 61. No, 61. 61 had that. The old 1829 style stock market, flat stock market, that doesn't matter to me, but where multiples of your stock value affect. Well, here, let's see what it is, because I left this out. I think it's in the stock market rolls, which is kind of a crappy place, but it's so hard. Movement in stock prices. Yeah, this is pretty common, actually. So if you operate and withhold dividends, your share price goes down to the left. If you pay full or half dividends greater than or equal to the amount market value of the corporation, your share price moves to the right. So it's going to be hard to drive your share price up. You've got to get really good stock, really good operating rounds to drive your share price up. That's an interesting view. And it doesn't matter whether you pay out full or half. And if you don't make that limit, you end up keeping your stock value steady. You're not doing anything impressive. Different concepts in this game that are going to play out, and it's going to be an exploratory game. There's no question of that for me. Some of you, if you see me screwing up rules, don't get on my case about it, but feel free to chime in and tell me what I'm doing wrong, because I'd like to be able to add that. At least, if you do it anyway, because if somebody's watching it, it'll help them. But I can add it to the video, because it gets distributed across several different sites, and wherever you mention it may not be viewed everywhere. And also, by the time I'm done vidding it, by the time I'm past some decision point or something, it's still very helpful for you to tell me, hey, you're playing it maybe by the rules, but really missing the spirit of the game. Remember, though, I'm not interested in binary win-loss. If you're looking at how can I optimize my chances of being the number one player or number two player or whatever, I don't really care about that. My view towards what you want to do to a game is you want to optimize your chances of not doing poorly, right? You want to aim for first place, and if you can end the game early and get first place, that's great. But what you don't want to do necessarily, you might want to do it, but you don't necessarily want to try to arrange for a short game that you're less likely to survive. It's worse to lose the game by going bankrupt than it is to place moderately well. So if your chances are, hey, I can probably place, pretty well if somebody goes bankrupt and it's not me, but there's a good chance I'll go bankrupt, forget that. If you're not going to make it through the long game, and it doesn't matter with this one. This one's got the fix in for it. You can't count on bankrupting someone out. So I shouldn't even be saying this. Let's end it up.